So good morning everyone. In the next topic, what we are going to see is physical resource blocks for OFDME. So in the previous video, we had seen about the frame structures. So frame structure 1 and 2 we had seen. Now we will go for the physical resource blocks for OFDME. So the physical resource, the physical resources and the downlink in each slot, it is going to be the physical resources and the downlink in each slot is going to be decided by the time frequency grid. So here the time frequency grid is going to be called as the resource grid. So here in this, your x-axis is going to denote the time where each element or each block is going to be represented by an OFDME symbol, and the y component is going to be represented by the frequency components where it is going to represent your OFDME subcarriers there. So here in your resource element, a group of a resource element is nothing but the smallest unit that is going to be present, or smallest element that is going to be present in the resource grid is going to be called as the resource element, where a resource element is going to be defined by k comma l, where k is going to be the number of subcarriers which you are going to have in the resource resource blocks, and l is going to be the number of symbols that is going to be available in the resource blocks. So totally in this resource grid, you are going to have a number of resource blocks there. So basically a resource block will consist of 12 subcarriers and 7 OFDME symbols there. So more number of subcarriers will be allocated, now more number of resource blocks will be allocated in one resource grid, and one slot is going to be consisting of more number of resource blocks. So here your total number of subcarriers is going to be the number of subcarriers into the number of resource blocks. So totally how many resource blocks you are going to have in the subgrid into your number of subcarriers minus your 1 is going to be the total number of subcarriers you are going to have there. So here we are going to see in detail about the resource grid there. So the number of downlink resource blocks, the resource blocks is going to depend on the transmission width. So here I said a resource grid is going to consist of number of resource grids, resource blocks, and the number of resource blocks are going to be decided based on the transmission bandwidth, and the minimum resource block can be 6 and maximum can be 110. So the number of subcarriers in each resource block is going to depend on the subcarrier spacing. So a subcarrier spacing, here we are going to take your del f to be 180 kilohertz. And the number of OFDM symbols which is going to be in each block is going to depend on both your cyclic prefix length and the subcarrier spacing. And your multi-antenna transmission is going to be available. In a multi-antenna transmission, we are going to have one resource grid per antenna port. So here antenna port is going to have your associated reference signal which may not be correspond to the physical antenna. Your antenna port is not a physical antenna. It is going to be associated, that port is going to be defined with respect to your associated reference signal what you are going to use, and the set of antenna ports are going to depend on the reference signal what you are going to have in the configuration of the cell. So yes, there are going to be three types of configurations. One is your specific reference signal, one is your multi-broadcast signal frequency network, and the other one is going to be user equipment specific reference cell there, reference signal. So suppose if it is going to be a cell specific reference signal, the number of antenna ports are going to be 1, 2 or 4, which is going to be represented by P. P is going to represent the number of antenna ports in a particular cell there. So here if the antenna port number is going to be 1, that means it can occupy 0, only 0 it can occupy there. If it is going to be 2, then the number of ports is going to be 0, 1. Then if the number of ports is going to be P is equivalent to 4, antenna ports is 4, means in that case your P ranges from 0, 1, 2 and 3. Next is your multimedia single frequency network, where your signals are going to be transmitted on an antenna port where P is equivalent to 4. Next is if I am going to use your user equipment specific reference signal, means in that case the antenna port value, P value will be 5. So these are the different reference signals and the number of antenna ports that are going to be used in the cell there. Next is, as I said, the resource element. Resource element is nothing but the smallest element in the resource grid, and it is going to be defined by the index pair k comma l, where in a slot k is nothing but the number of resource blocks minus 1, and l is going to be the number of symbols minus 1. So number of resource blocks is nothing but the number of resource blocks into your number of subcarriers, the total slot is going to be minus 1. So size of the each resource element is going to depend upon the cyclic prefix and the subcarrier spacing there. So a resource block, here we have two types of resource block. One is your physical resource block and the other one is going to be your virtual resource block. So one is going to be your physical resource block and other one is going to be the virtual resource block. Your resource allocation. So resource allocation is nothing but we are going to assign the resource blocks to different user equipments. So when I'm going to assign the resource blocks to different user equipments, your virtual resource block is going to support both block-wise transmission, that is localized transmission, or transmission on non-consecutive subcarriers, that is distributed. So which is going to maximize the frequency diversity. So resource allocation is, it is going to assign the resource blocks to different user equipments where virtual resource block supports both localized as well as distributed. Localized means it is going to be a block-wise transmission, and if it is distributed means it is going to be transmission on non-consecutive subcarriers. So which is going to be used to maximize the frequency diversity. And it is going to support, a resource allocation is going to support three allocation types. One is type 0, type 1 and type 2. So your downlink scheduling is going to be, the downlink scheduling is going to be done at the E node B, which is going to be based on the channel quality information which is going to be fed back from the user equipment. So here your the channel quality information is going to be sent by the user equipment. So based on the feedback from the user equipment, the channel quality information is going to the E node B is going to transmit the data. So here in this case, your data will be transmitted from the user equipment to the E node B based on the quality of the channel. So how the quality of the channel is going to be assessed is based on the channel quality information which is going to be fed back from the user equipment. And the download resource assignment is going to be done. So the resource assignment information, so user equipment should know to in which channel it should send. So for that, the user equipment, the E node B is going to send the downlink resource assignment information to the user equipment on your physical downlink control channel there. So the number of physical resource blocks or resource element is going to be K by the number of subcarriers in resource block. So here PRB supports type 0 and type 1. So type 0 resource allocation is going to be, here several consecutive PRBs are going to constitute a resource block group and allocated resource block groups to a certain user equipment that do need not be adjacent. That is, the allocated user equipments need not be adjacent, and the RBG size, the size is going to be, the resource block group size is going to be the number of PRBs in the RBG. So here your type 0 is nothing but several consecutive PRBs, the physical resource blocks constitute an RBG, and RBG size is going to depend upon the P, the number of PRBs in each RBG, and the allocated RBGs to a certain user equipment need not be adjacent to each other then. So in the next slide, we'll be seeing the diagram and we'll explain in detail there. So in type 1 resource allocation, all the RBGs are grouped into number of RBG subsets, and the PRBs, the physical resource blocks inside a selected RBG subset, are allocated to the user equipment. So here in this case, the resource assignment information consists of three fields. First field is going to be the selected RBG subset. Second field is whether offset is going to be applied or not. Third field is going to be the mid-map indicating the PRBs inside the selected RBG subset. So here we are going to have, this is your type 0. So type 0, here I am going to take the P value to be 3. So if the RBG size is going to be 3, that is P is going to be 3, then the number of system bandwidth is going to be 63. The maximum it can have a bandwidth of 63 there. So here I have taken the total physical resource blocks. If it is going to be a 10 megahertz bandwidth, I am going to have 50 resource blocks to be present. So in this 50 resource blocks, how it is going to be divided is, this 10 megahertz bandwidth with 50 resource blocks, how it is going to be divided is, the P value is going to be here 3. So P value is going to be 3 means the resource block group is going to be 0, 1 and 2. So this 50 blocks are going to be grouped in terms of 3. So 3 groups, 3 blocks form a resource block group 1, 0. And next to 3 is going to be resource block group 1. Next to 3 is going to be resource block group 2. 3. Like that it is going to be till your resource block 16. So here we have got the 16 resource blocks there. So sorry, totally 17 resource blocks you have got it. And next is the bitmap. So bitmap is based on this, what is going to be the bit string I want to transmit. So the bit string is going to be here. For the first resource block, it is going to be 0. Next is 1, 0. And next one is going to be 1. So the bit 2 is going to be 1. And this bit 1 is going to be here. So this is what the data is going to be transmitted there. So here your bitmap is going to represent which RBG is going to be allocated for data transmission. So these two RBGs are going to be allocated for data transmission, and this RBG is also going to be allocated for data transmission there. That means it is allocated to the user equipment. This allocation need not be adjacent to each other in the case of type 0. And next is type 2. So in type 2, as I said, you are going to have your resource blocks, say same 10 megahertz, 50 resource block. You are going to have, this is the resource, physical resource blocks, and down is going to be the RBG groups. So RBG group, total 17 groups you are going to have, and these 17 groups are going to be divided into 3. So first one is going to, so P value is going to be 3. P value is going to be 3 means 0, 1, 2. That means your subsets are going to be repeated. After every 3 subsets, it is going to be repeated. So here in this case, this one will be subset 0, subset 1, subset 2. Again, it will be subset 0, subset 1, subset 2. Again, subset 0, subset 1, subset 2. So it has been continuously repeated like this. In this, I want to decide in which subset I want to transmit. So that is going to be given by this subset, your bit string 0, 1. So 0, 1 means here in this case, this is your 0, 1. First subset has been selected. So in this first subset selected, I want to assign to which the resource blocks to a particular user equipment. So how I am going to select this? You are going to have this 1 to be present. 1 is corresponds to bit 2. 0, 1, 2, 3. So here bit 2. Bit 2 is nothing but this is your bit 2 there. So next is your bit 3. So bit 3 is nothing but my second session here is going to be bit 3 here. And this is going to be 5. So these physical resource blocks are going to be assigned to the user equipment there. And this 0 is going to denote here for a subset 2. The next 0 is going to denote in the bit position of the resource blocks allocated for each of the subset. So here this is how your type 2 is going to be present with the help of subsets. And next is your type 2 resource allocation. So we had seen your type 0 and type 1. Next is your type 2. So a type 2 resource allocation is going to be defined for your DCI format. So here in this case, your physical resource blocks are not allocated. So VRBs are going to be, we are not going to use your physical resource blocks, only your virtual resource blocks are going to be used, and these virtual resource blocks are going to be mapped to your physical resource blocks, and your virtual resource blocks are going to be of the same size as your physical resource blocks. So here two types of virtual resource blocks we are going to have. One is localized, one is going to be distributed. So for each type of virtual resource blocks, a pair of VRBs, there is a pair of VRBs over the two slots. I'm going to take two slots. The two slots are going to form a subframe, and these two slots are going to be given or assigned together with a single VRB number. So for each type of VRB, a pair of VRBs over the two slots, that is two slots from a subframe, and these two slots are going to be given with a single VRB number there. So the resource allocation is going to be, if it is localized, it is going to be continuous, or if it is distributed, it is not going to be a continuous one. So in this one bit flag, it is going to indicate whether it is going to be a localized VRBs or your distributed VRBs. Next is your supported MIMO modes. So supported MIMO modes are going to be, there is your multi-input, multi-output MIMO modes are going to be a baseline antenna configuration. It is going to tell about the antenna configuration. So in your supported MIMO modes, we are going to have two antennas at the cell site and two antennas at the receive antennas at the user equipment there. So your downlink transmission is going to be, that is from the E node B to your user equipment. It can be either a single user MIMO or it can be a multi-user MIMO there. So if it is a single user MIMO, you are going to have one or multiple data streams are going to be transmitted to the single user equipment through space-time processing. If it is going to be a multi-user MIMO, then you are going to have the modulation data streams are going to be transmitted to different user equipments using the same time frequency resource there. So your single user MIMO modes are going to be, either it can be or transmit diversity with space frequency block codes, or open loop spatial multiplexing supporting 4 data streams, or closed loop spatial multiplexing with closed loop precoding as a special case when the channel rank is going to be 1. Next is your conventional direction of entry, that is your beam forming. Conventional direction of arrival based beam forming there. So my single user multi, that is your MIMO modes, are going to be supported by any one of these methods, by either by using your SFBC codes or by your open loop spatial multiplexing or your closed loop spatial multiplexing or direction of arrival, that is your beam forming here. So here your supported MIMO modes are is going to be restricted by your user equipment capability. So here in this case, your physical downlink shared channel is going to support the your MIMO mode, that is going to be other physical channels are going to support. So the other physical channels are going to support the MIMO modes and transmit, so it's going to support the transmit diversity except your physical multicast channel there. So physical multicast channel is going to support single antenna port transmission, and PDSH, that is your physical downlink shared channel, is going to support your transmit diversity there. So next is your uplinks single carrier FDMA radio resources. So in your single carrier FDMA radio resources, for uplink of data we'll be using single carrier FDMA radio resources, and for downlink we'll be using your OFDMA process. So why we are going to use a single carrier FDMA is going because it is going to have low peak to average power ratio, and because of that we are going to have a less expensive power amplifiers where your coverage is going to be improved. And here also in your SCFDMA, cyclic prefix is also going to be added there. And in the case of OFDMA, we are going to use your FFT methods, FFT signal processing methods, but in the case of SCFDMA, we are going to use your DFT spread OFDM there. So here in the, since you are going to use your DFT for processing of your signals, your receiver structure is going to be of high complexity, and then it is going to support your limited MIMO modes are going to be supported here. So the localized resource allocations are going to be done on consecutive subcarriers. These VRBs are going to be used here. And next is your frame structure. Coming to the frame structure, what we had seen, your structure 1 and 2, it is going to be same as the downlink, where in that downlink we had used your OFDMA symbols and OFDMA subcarriers, but in the uplink we are going to use your SCFDMA symbols and SCFDMA subcarriers there. So the physical resource blocks for your SCFDMA is going to be, it is also going to be the same, but in your OFDMA we are not going to use any DC subcarrier, but in the case of a single carrier FDMA we are going to use your DC subcarrier, where the DC interference is going to be spread over the modulation symbols there. So, and the precoding is going to be done using your DFT based precoding is going to be done. And since we are going to use only single antenna transmission, there is going to be no antenna port required for SCFDMA there. And your resource allocation, is going to be your frequency hopping. That is, your frequency hopping is going to, by doing your frequency hopping, it is going to provide the frequency diversity there. So by providing your frequency diversity, the user equipment can hop between your frequencies, whether within the allocated subframes or between the two subframes. So here in this case, your data, your user equipment can transfer the data between between the subframes or between the different subframes there. It can go for frequency hopping, so it can hop between the different frequencies there. Next is supported MIMO modes. So supported MIMO modes are going to be your multi-user MIMO is going to allocate the same time frequency response to two user equipment with each transmitting on a antenna. So here in your multi-user, we are going to have the two user equipments, and the two user equipments are going to be transmitting on the single antenna, and in the same time frequency response it is going to be, that is, it is going to share the same time frequency response resource. So we are going to go for spatial division multiple access there. So the advantage of going for spatial division multiple access is it requires only one transmit antenna per user equipment there. And to separate, so since it is going to have the same time frequency response, that means it's same resource space, the data stream should be separated for different user equipments. So how the data streams are going to be separated for different user equipments is based on the channel state information. So the channel state information is going to be required at the E node B. So the E node B E node B requires a channel state information. That the channel state information is going to be sent by the reference signal from the user equipment. So when it is going to be sent by two user equipments, the reference signals are going to be orthogonal to each other. Since it is going to be orthogonal to each other, interference can be avoided there. And by you going for your MIMO modes, it is going to require the power control there. So since your user equipments are going to be multiplexed on the same radio resource, you should have a power control over the signals there. So on the same anyway, the reference signals are going to be orthogonal between the user equipments. As a result, your inter-cell interference is going to be avoided. Next is your user equipment is going to consist of two or more transmit antennas. If it consists of two or more transmit antennas, in that case, closed loop adaptive antenna selection transmit diversity is going to be supported. So we said in a multi-user MIMO, is going to have only one transmit antenna per user equipment. So suppose if your user equipment is going to consist of two or more transmit antenna, then we have to go for closed loop adaptive antenna selection transmit diversity, which is going to be supported there. So user equipment need one transmit chain and amplifier. So it is going to, your antenna is going to provide the best channel to E node B, selected feedback from the E node B. So here in this case, the user equipment will select the best antenna, that is your user equipment will select the channel, send the quality information, this channel state information to the E node B. Based on that, it will allocate the resource and your user equipment can transmit it through the antenna to the best channel to your E node B. Thank you.